Okay, well, those are the headlines that we are going to be tracking for you all day on ET Now. Well, let's welcome on board our very first guest on the show. Joining me is Sanjeev Bajaj, Joint Chairman and MD of Bajaj Capital. Sanjeev, thank you so much for taking our time and joining us on the show. You know, I wanted to dedicate this particular show to retired individuals. You know, when you're retired, your profile as an investor changes enormously. You have maybe a lower income stream or perhaps a zero income stream, at least from your regular source of income that's either a business or a job which you may be conducting prior to your retirement. Plus, you know, your expenses don't stop. In fact, they pile on because, you know, God forbid you've got all of your medical expenses and, you know, medical care related expenses that only keep piling up. So all of those expenses remain, increase if not remain really. So that's a dual issue really. So where do you think retired individuals should invest their the money, the corpus that they've saved up for retirement? What are the instruments that are suitable for them?
So Mubina, thank you for calling me here, and it's such an amazing topic, and it is a very relevant and important topic because given the Indian's population profile, we have maybe lakhs of people retiring every month and they have to take care of their savings. So for me, you know, there are a lot of things where a retiree needs to do. The first thing for me, given in the COVID environment, is that he has to look at his health insurance. Now, whether his company is going to continue providing him his health insurance, and in PSUs, we have seen the health insurance provided is only maybe a 2 lakh rupee with a 2,000 rupee room rate cap. So now the first thing he has to invest in is health insurance because you have to preserve and conserve your money. So that is the first instrument. Then the second thing I would like to tell the retirees, okay, look guys, you still have another 25 years of game ahead of you. So it is not only that retirees have this misconception that all my money needs to be in debt. That should not be there. You have to, you know, the rule of thumb says it is your age minus 100. It should be your debt, your equity allocation. So you must have some part of your assets in an equity fund. And yes, you can choose to be conservative. You can choose for blue chip or large cap funds, which have a lower volatility. And you can do maybe a 10, 15, 20% allocations to flexi caps or small and mid caps because those carry a higher risk. Then there are amazing government schemes. There's a small saving investment scheme which gives 7.4% return. There is a very popular Vaya Vandana scheme from LIC which gives a 7.4% return. These are slightly illiquid and they are taxable. So, you know, you have to take a call depending on your tax status. So if you are still going to be paying tax after retirement, then there maybe are some better options for you. But if you are not going to be paying taxes, then these schemes which give you 7.4%, which is 2% above the bank, and they have some amount of illiquidity, but you, after paying an exit load of 1 or 2%, you can get out if you need to. So these are giving you 7.4%. Personally, I like the LIC Vaya Vandana because their processing is very smooth and good. So I think that's a good scheme. Then also you should look at some amount of money in a bank FD, which is going to be your emergency corpus that you can get out anytime. And my favorite scheme for retirees is debt mutual funds. Now, debt mutual funds, again, is a very complicated area. They are actually more difficult than even equity because there are so many types of debt funds. So use a proper advisor. But debt mutual funds with a systematic withdrawal plan is the most tax effective and most powerful tool for retirees, where you can choose the amount of money you want irrespective of the interest rate you are getting. So we personally recommend PSU debt fund and a medium-term debt fund. PSU has given a 4.5% to 5% return last year, and the medium-term corporate bond fund, corporate fund has given you about 6.5% type of a return. But this also becomes very tax-effective because systematic withdrawal plan, you know, the taxation in debt is very soft after 3 years because you get inflation. But when you're doing a systematic withdrawal, it is assumed you're withdrawing your capital first. So, you know, overall, it becomes very, very tax effective. You are paying a very minimal tax and you can choose your withdrawal amount. And if you go to a good financial planner or a retirement planner, he can help you understand, okay, look, if you need, you have an X amount of corpus, you need Y amount of income every month. How long is your investments going to last? So you can do those permutation combinations and figure out what is the right withdrawal for me, that in which I can run my house or I can run, and if I need to work, what is the additional income I need.
You know, I think that's one of the most trickiest part as well, right? Figuring out how much will you actually need during retirement. And yes, when you're already retired, I suppose it's a little easier. But when you're younger, you have no idea what things are going to be like maybe 10, 15, 20 years down the line. But we'll come to that. Let's keep it first for our retired and, you know, senior citizens as well. You know, you mentioned that it's all right for senior citizens to put money in large caps and flexi caps as well. But, you know, we see so much volatility in the equity market. So if you could advise a good split that, you know, how much should you put in these equity funds? Should you have maybe a smaller quantum in equity funds compared to what you would put prior to your retirement?
Yeah, definitely needs to be a smaller amount because you can't take volatility in life. But see, you have to understand equities, if you have a 5 to 10 year horizon, are pretty safe. You can 10-year horizon, they're very, very safe because over you will see some cycles, they'll go up, they'll go down. If you're invested in the right funds, it's absolutely fine. And what you are banking on is that, look, Indian economy is going to grow at 6 to 7%. You know, on a worst case scenario, nowadays they are saying that we may even cross double digits. I don't know whether that will happen or not. But and the best companies in the market will go twice that rate. So over a long term, you should get almost double the India's growth rate in a very good company because these companies are outperforming India. And what you are doing is that, look, if you have a long term horizon, and even if you're 60, you know, you're not going to use all your money between 60 to 65. You also want money when you're 75, 80. So you're saving for that. So part of your money has even a 15, 20 year allocation. So why should you not take advantage of a equity fund which can give you 10 to 12% return. I'm not saying less, you know, but I'm not talking about crazy returns we have gotten last money. 12%, which is a very doable return. You need that as a part of your portfolio, and they are very, very tax effective given the tax treatment. So you must have it. So on a simple rule of thumb, as they say, it depends on the corpus amount. If your corpus is larger, you can have maybe between 25 to 40% of your total corpus in equity, which is going to be used later on. And as you need the money, as you're closer to that, you can keep withdrawing that, or you can keep transferring that into a debt fund and withdrawing from there. But if you have a lower corpus, then obviously you cannot take that much risk. You have this amount should be about 20-25% of your corpus. But also keep in mind, look, people look at their investments and then they have their PFs, they have their EPFs, and they have their XYZ. All these are part of your portfolio. So when you do your debt and equity allocation, you have to do it on your complete portfolio rather than just doing it on one part. And today, you know, a lot of good companies like us are offering these retirement plans and other stuff. So you can get a proper retirement plan made so that you understand how long your money is going to last. And it is very, very important. And if you are a pre-retiree, then equity is very, very important for you. Because, you know, you want to be a part of India's growth story. There are so many amazing companies. There are so many amazing entrepreneurs. And everybody is talking about the India story. Now, you have the feeder funds also where you can be playing a part of the global story. So why shouldn't you be a part of a Google growth story or an Apple? So today you can invest in these through flexi caps, and you can invest in these through feeder funds. So there are amazing opportunities available. I feel 20% of your portfolio for the younger lot needs to be at least in international funds. And you can make a very good equity allocation. And there you can take slightly more risk and have a, you know, part of your portfolio in small and mid caps also. But if you don't want to get into that, there's a very good category called flexi caps, where the fund manager will move between the various options for you. You can choose a good flexi cap fund. And, if you're younger, saving for retirement, then it is very, very important. So, Mubina, you raised a very important question. How much to...
Guys, I can't hear anything. I think just before Sanjeev could continue, we've just had some trouble with his network, but yeah, it's like Sanjeev said, you know, if you want to sort of take part in a country's growth story, the best way to do so is by investing in the country's equity markets. India will grow by 8%, maybe double digits as well. And if you want to take part in that growth story, you can do so by equity funds. So it's not a bad idea for senior citizens as well to put their money in large caps and flexi caps. But of course, don't put as much as you would put prior to your retirement. But yeah, Sanjeev, you know, you were talking about another point, so continue with that.
Yeah, so I was talking about, you asked a very important question on how much to save for retirement. Now, this is a place where people get lost. So, you know, what you need to do is, guys, you need to fix out your needs. And that's going to be one of the most difficult exercises of your life, that you have to put it down on a piece of paper, which is called a basic financial planning, where you need to put in and identify your needs and you need to prioritize them. So one of my needs is retirement. I need to spend on my children's marriage. I need to spend on my children's marriage. I need education. I need to buy a house. I need to do, you know, plan my vacations, enjoy my life. So you put in these needs and you identify and then you prioritize them. Okay, this is something I can't do without. This is something I have to do. If today I want to do it as per this style, this is the amount of money I need. And then you inflation adjust it. You put it, okay, if inflation is 6%, then after 20 years when I'm planning to retire, how much will this amount be? And you reach that amount and then you decide, okay, this is the standard. But again, what happens, a mistake most of the people will make. Today, if your salary is, imagine 1 or 1.5 lakhs, you know, and you decide your retirement corpus on that basis, okay, look, I need 1.5 lakhs after my retirement. But remember that after 20 years, your salary may be much higher, you know, even inflation adjusted, because you have grown in life and you are used to a much better lifestyle. So you need to plan for that also. So it's a slightly complicated exercise, but that's something we have to do if you want to live a good, you know, wealthy life. And it can be amazing. Today we are living in a world which has high longevity. People are easily living up to 90, 95, and you don't want to be dependent upon anybody. And with a slight amount of financial planning, starting on right time, you can have enough purpose to enjoy, have fun, and at the same time live the kind of life you want to live.
Okay, understood. You know, you spoke about a couple of government schemes like the Vaya Vandana Yojana. We also have NPS among them. So lots of investment instruments, a few of them at least, where people can put their retirement money. And most importantly, they are government backed. So of all of them, you spoke that Vaya Vandana is one of your favorites. How would you rate all of them, senior citizens, etc.? You know, what would be your pecking order if you had to put your money during retirement?
Okay, so my pecking order is that, look, it is either if I'm a pre-retiree, like Mubina, if I'm on your shoes or I'm in my own shoes, so my favorite scheme for planning for retirement is NPS, which is called the National Pension Scheme. It is probably very similar to a balanced mutual fund with hardly any charges. Mutual fund charge you about 1.4%. Here the charges are 0.01%. Or maybe in future they'll become 0.1%. So it's very, very cheap. We have been delivering amazing returns. So like my own portfolio for the last 10 years has given a 12%, 13% IRR CAGR. So it is delivering a very good return and it's very tax effective. So for 50,000 rupees, you save 15,000 rupee tax. And you can also contribute 10% of your salary income into this without any tax. So if you're a high taxpayer, this is an amazing scheme for you where your 30-35% return is just coming from tax saving. Plus additional, it grows at about 10-12%. Now, if you are post-retirement, for me, my favorite scheme, as I said, is a Vaya Vandana scheme, which is from LIC because their servicing is very good. Post office, I've seen people have sometimes they have some servicing issues. But otherwise, the senior citizen scheme is also quite good. So my pecking order would be Vaya Vandana scheme. Please look at it, 7.4% assured return. Then the second scheme that you need to look out is the immediate annuity and deferred annuity. These are offered by life insurance companies. So they are slightly long-term. Here you have to only opt for return of premium because a lot of people make the mistake. There are some schemes which don't return the premium. but they give you a higher return. So you have to opt for a return the premium, and they'll give you between 6 to 7% return, but they are guaranteed for the rest of your life. So you don't need to bother about the fluctuation. Then I would put some amount of money in bank FDs. Then I would put some amount of money in corporate FDs. But I will only opt for maybe a 1 year, 2 year, 3 year term, not more than that. For a retiree, you should not opt and go for only AAA rated companies like HDFC or maybe, you know, very, very good companies, only a AAA rated companies. And if it's a private company, you're slightly insecure, maybe choose a 1 year term so that you can every year take a call, is this company right? And just AAA rated, very good brand names. And then after that, you know, again, my major corpus will go into debt funds with a systematic withdrawal plan. Because there, you know, with an interest rate, what happens is that you can't control the amount of money you need. Suppose you're investing 10 lakh rupees, you are gonna get 7% interest, but that may not be enough. So you may need 15, 20,000 or 30,000 rupees a month. With a systematic withdrawal plan, you can define that. Yes, you will consume your capital also, but at the end of the day, this is your money. And one of the mistakes Indians make is they keep conserving their capital. Guys, it is for you to spend. It is your money. You know, if you just want to pass it on to the next generation and not going to enjoy it, you know, you have to do a mixture of both. And for pre-retirees, again, what I tell a lot of people, Indians want to give a corpus to their children or their grandchildren. Amazing. But today, it's not only that you don't spend your money. You can buy these, we have these plans which are 99-year term plans, or these are called, you know, family, you know, which are planned for legacy planning. So you can buy a life insurance plan where you say, okay, I want to give 5 crores, 10 crores, 15 crores. Buy that life insurance plan till the age of 99. It's very unlikely for a person to cross 99. Maybe you have a 2% chance, then you're very lucky. Otherwise, buy these legacy planning things where you want to give the money to your children, and then you can afford to enjoy your money, and you can consume out your money also. So you don't have to keep conserving the capital. So systematic withdrawal plan, guys, is the bread and butter product for all people who are post-retirement. I think it is the most flexible and best product. So for me, if I was to answer your question, one product that you must have a part of your portfolio, sure, is called systematic withdrawal plan. It will be the best product you can get.
Yeah. Understood. All right. Well, you know what? We also will answer some questions and queries from our viewers. So for all of our viewers, if you'd like to connect with us, ask us any questions on this topic, our email address is themoneyshow@etnow.tv. Well, for now, let's take on board some questions already received. Ravi Khan says, presently, my money is lying in a fixed deposit with interest of 5.4%. Please advise me some better options for a 55-year-old. Okay, so I guess not surprising that Ravi Kant has all of his money just in a fixed deposit. You know, Sanjeev, maybe 1-2 years ago, we would have said that, okay, fixed deposit 7%, but we were still not happy with it. Now it's even lower, it's just 5.5%. Inflation itself, the last reading is 6%. So, I mean, the FD is definitely not going to cut it, and I'm glad Ravi Kant as well has come to that realization. So what would you recommend Ravi Kant for him? And clearly the fact that he's always stuck to FD, we should understand that his own willingness to take on more risk seems to be a little limited.
Ravi, it depends on whether you're a pre-retiree or a post-retiree. So if you're, I'm assuming you're a pre-retiree who's going to retire soon. So point is that for you, I would recommend that at least put 50% or 40 to 50% of your corpus into equity funds and choose maybe large caps or, you know, blue chip funds, which have lesser volatility. And as we were discussing with Mubina, that you can choose some flexi cap also. So I would put 50% of my corpus into equity funds, which are for the long run, and have at least a 10-year horizon to that. The remaining amount of money, I would retain maybe 10% of it in the bank FD for an emergency funding, and maybe remove 30-40% of it into a debt fund. And debt fund you can choose depending on your risk appetite. As I said, medium duration fund are a good option, which are giving a decent amount of returns. And there, if you need any regular income, you can opt for a systematic withdrawal plan. If you don't need regular income, then you can let the money accumulate. So these are the best options for you that you should look at. And, this is what I would like to recommend to you.
Okay, understood. Let's move on to our next question. It's coming in on debt funds, something that you as well had mentioned, Sanjeev, is a great investment option for senior citizens. Shiva Kumar Burli says, if I hold bonds for a period of 1 or 3 years, can I expect my returns to match the underlying coupon rate of the bonds held by that fund? He says, I find market yields are less than coupon rates on a day-to-day basis. Sometimes coupon rates are even below short-term bank FD rates. Okay, very interesting observation by Mr. Burli. You know, debt funds always have so many jargons as well accompanying them. So this question, many of our viewers may find to be a little too jargony. But yeah, if you could simplify it as well, Sanjeev, for our viewers, is Mr. Burli right in his line of thinking?
Yeah, I think what Mr. Burli is talking about is corporate bonds. He is talking about investing directly in a corporate bonds. So Mr. Burli, I like to say, unless you're a super high net worth individual, this is a very, very risky proposition. And this is something I don't recommend to everybody because you're going in for a concentration risk. You know, look at, take an IL, suppose you were invested in ILSS, which was a AAA rated company, went from AAA rated to zero, almost to default, within a period of days, and you couldn't have done anything. And imagine you were, all your money was in a AAA rated bond. Or what happened with the Yes Bank Tier 1 bonds. So Mr. Murli, it's a very, very risky option for you. I would say that move your money from direct bonds to debt funds. Because there, you know, what you are also getting is a advantage of diversification. They are going to buy 30 bonds for you compared to you putting your money in one or two bonds. So please don't concentrate. That's why mutual fund rules have also been created where not more than 5% corpus can be within one scheme. So point is that you have to diversify your money. Even if something goes wrong or even 2-3 things go wrong, your 85-90% of your capital is there. And what you are talking about, see, what happens is that what you are talking about is that there is a coupon rate at which the bonds were issued. Now there is a trading rate at which they are being traded. So depending on the quality of bonds, sometimes they are traded at a premium, they are traded at a discount. So always also remember the bonds are highly illiquid. So it's very easy to buy a bond, corporate bond, but it's very difficult to sell it because, you know, at the end of the day, retail buyers are limited. These bonds are generally bought by large institutions and they are very happy selling at a profit, but they are very unhappy buying it back. Because so sometimes, you know, being able to sell those bonds also becomes a challenge and you have to hold them on to maturity. If you're talking about tier one bonds from banks, they can virtually be perpetual. So, you know, so you have to keep that in mind where these are perpetual bonds. After 10 years, there is a buyback option, but the bank doesn't have to give it and it can choose to roll over at its own discretion. So please be very, very careful. Doing this, again, as what we are recommending to others, it may make more sense for you to move your money into a banking PSU fund or a medium-term fund, depending on your risk profile. And if you want to be in the long-term, then you can take a probably a long-term fund also if you're going to hold on. And you're going to hold on till maturity of the corpus. And there are a lot of ways to look at bond and debt funds. So you need definitely for, you know, even more...
We just got disconnected from Sanjeev just as he was completing his point. But anyway, with that, we're completely out of time too. Sanjeev, thanks so much for joining us today on The Money Show and, you know, helping our viewers as well out with their questions and queries. Folks, if you have a question we've not been able to answer, don't fret. We'll be back tomorrow same time on The Money Show. But for now, we'll take a very short break. Be right back with more.